All right, so then the next thing we're gonna learn about is what's a genotype. Genotype is, I will give you the formal definition, and then in a few slides I'll tell you how we actually will encode these, which will be useful. But a genotype is just, when you look at a specific individual, what does their genetics look like at a very specific location? So if I look at like this location of my genome, there my genotype is GC. And like here, this, here my genotype is AA. Here it's TT, here it's AT. It's just what genetics does a person have at some defined location that you're looking at. And that's your genotype. All right, so what we're really interested in most of the time when we're doing genetics is looking at the genetic variation one person has and comparing them to another person. For instance, somebody who has a disease versus somebody who doesn't have the disease. However, when we do it, most of the time when we look at the genetics, we're the same. In fact, between any two random people, you're like 99.9% identical in your genome. And it's just this like 0.1%, these numbers don't matter. It's just this 0.1% difference that is actually driving all the difference in like risk of diseases, how tall you are, all these different traits has actually been driven by a very small amount of genetics, but mainly by environment, like how much do you eat, stuff like that. But there is a genetic portion, and there's not very much variation that actually drives that genetic portion. And now we have a whole bunch more genetic variants. So these are kind of the big terms you're gonna hear all the time. So we already talked about a SNP. Oh, let's forget about that A for a moment. So we already talked about a SNP. This is just when you have one position in the genome that can take on multiple nucleotides. You also have what's called an indel. It should be kind of obvious what it is here. It stands for insertion or deletion. And essentially, an indel is a region of the genome, and here it's three base pairs long, where some people have some genetic code and other people are missing it. So this person has the deletion, this person has the insertion. You then also have things called structural variation, and this is in quotes because structural variation is this whole field. There's tons of it, not just what I'm showing here. This is just a very small example of one of the many possibilities. So for here, the CTT in one individual, or in one chromosome, on this other person's other chromosome, it just got reversed. So this is, I think, called an inversion. But SNPs and indels, people either like have it or they don't have it, or they have one version of a nucleotide or the other version, whereas structural variants can be like, I'll take this region of the genome and I'll shove it into an entirely different region of the genome. Like, it's structural variation really is complicated and messes things up, and probably you're not gonna hear much about it because it's hard to study. And if you do hear a lot about it, somebody will take the time to actually walk you through it all.
And I might do a talk about it, so you might hear about it then.
Yes, there'll be a module coming. all right, so first of all, there's some words to confuse you. These terms oftentimes get used interchangeably. It's not great, so let's talk through them a little bit. First of all, variant is a great catch-all word. People will refer to all of these as variants. And they will interchange like SNP for variant or indel for variant or structural variant for just a variant. If this deletion here is seen only in a very, very small number of people, it's more likely that they'll call it a variant as opposed to an indel. Where if it's in lots of people, it's more likely to be called an indel. There's no like hard, fast threshold of what's the difference between like a variant in a SNP or an indel or a structural variant, but as things get rarer, people tend to use the words variant and mutation a lot. Whereas things are more frequent in the population and seen more often, then they tend to use the actual words. Which brings us to this A. So let's start here. Let's see that half the chromosomes I look at, like if I sample 1,000 people, half those people have a C, the other half have a G. That's definitely a SNP. It's a single nucleotide polymorphism that's usually like common things. However, if I sample 1,000 people and I'm the only one who has this A, then we'll probably refer to this as a single nucleotide variant. Don't quite know why. It's technically a SNP. You could call it a rare SNP, but people tend to refer to this as like a single nucleotide variant, or just a variant, or just a mutation. Which brings us to the next fun word. So basically you have the genome, and sometimes your genetics don't look like your parents' genetics because you have random mutations that occur. And mutation is kind of the first time you ever see something in the genome that you've never seen before. People definitely call it a mutation. And then as you see it more often, it morphs into other terms. But when someone says mutation, they're really saying, like, we saw something in the genome that we've just never seen before. And it can be a SNP, it can be an indel, it can be a structural variant. All of these that are common in a population at one point were mutations. And then you have the next term, which is allele, which is probably actually one of the most important terms on this. So when I say SNP, I'm not referring to the C or the G. I'm just referring to this position in the genome where we observe that more than one nucleotide can take on the region. When I say indel, I'm not referring to either of these, but rather this position in the genome that can take on different values. So an allele are the different values that can take on. So this indel has a GTA allele and a, like, missing allele. And so the SNP, the two alleles that we observe are the C and the G. All right, how are we doing so far? Should I go over any of these terms again? It's a lot, I'm sorry, they're vague. I'm gonna change it. Okay. Yes.
So if you had like a huge structural variation, like big inversion or something, would you also call that a mutation? Or is that normally just for like smaller SNPs and stuff?
So it depends on the context, but I would say a lot of, if it's a really big structural variation, it's probably the person's gonna say this is a structural variant.
Okay.
Or a structural mutation might be a way, they might define it a little bit more. Whereas like something like this, the first time I saw it, I'd probably just call that a mutation. But if you have like a huge inversion along the genome that's like largely structural, because you could also just imagine this as just being two SNPs
right. That
exist, and so it's kind of ambiguous if it's an inversion or if it's a SNP or two SNPs. But, and again, if it's the first time you've seen it, like you have some person with some super rare disease, and you're like, maybe there's one thing in the genome which is causing this disease, and you see this giant inversion, people would probably call that like a mutation.
Okay.
Or a structural variant or something like that.
I would avoid using the word mutation because people have, like, you can use it when you're talking to like your professor or your grad student about what something is, but there, I know several professors who have strong feelings about what constitutes a mutation, and all of their opinions about that.
Right, nor are they wrong.
All of their opinions are different from each other. And so, with the word mutation particularly, I would just avoid using it when you're talking to a fancy schmancy person or writing a paper. For some people, it means that it's a disease-causing variant. For some people, it means that you caused that variant by using mutagenesis. For some people, it means that it's like a de novo variant, which means that it's only happened at one time. So I just wouldn't say mutation, except for colloquially, if I were you.
Yeah. You can always use one of these terms and just be like, it's a SNP that we've only observed like one of the alleles once. You can be more descriptive. But when you're hearing talks and stuff, a lot of people will be talking about structural variant, but that's like a lot of syllables, and so like mutation,
yeah,
it's easier to say. And that's why there's so much interchange, because everyone listening knows what's being referred to, and so we just get the pass, except for like new people who aren't in the field who are like, I don't know what's going on. So that's why we're here.
You're usually safe with the word variant, though.
Yes, if you use variant, that covers all of these. You can call everything up here a variant, and no one will call you out on it.
Yeah.
But in general, whenever you hear these words, just be like, oh, there's something in the genome where like some people have it and some people don't. And what that is like actually not that important, because at the end of the day, we're going to code it all as zeros and ones anyways.